Hey, what's up? It's Jim, and today I'm going to talk about the film Beneath the Planet of the Apes. This is the first Planet of the Apes sequel ever made, and with Dawn of the Planet of the Apes coming out this Friday, I thought it'd be cool to revisit the very first Planet of the Apes sequel in the franchise. And at the time this was made, sequels weren't as commonplace as they are now. Now, pretty much, if you have a successful movie, it's definitely getting a sequel. But at the time, it was pretty unusual. And they weren't really looked at in a positive light. Actually, in the documentary I saw with this film, Charlton Heston even says, what, like the Andy Hardy series? It just wasn't really looked at as kind of an A picture. Now, Beneath the Planet of the Apes did have a smaller budget. It was actually because 20th Century Fox was on tougher times. They'd gone through a lot of flops, so I don't think they necessarily would have done it that way. It kind of worked out. But a lot of the times that was the case. At the beginning of this film, think it's just kind of like one of those sequels from the time period. But this film takes a pretty good turn that makes it incredibly interesting, fun, and a weird snapshot of what a major studio film from the early 1970s was like, and what a major studio sequel could be like at this time. Beneath the Planet of the Apes starts out really like a normal kind of sequel. Since Charlton Heston said he would only be in the film if he died in the first few scenes, and then they convinced him to be in the beginning and the end, they had to get James Franciscus to play an astronaut who was sent on a rescue mission to find Charlton Heston's Taylor character. And he goes and he explains, he goes through a time stream thing. How he understands that, I don't exactly know, but whatever. Maybe, did they explain that in the first one? I don't remember. So he crash lands on Earth, but you don't see the crash landing. He's just there, and he's starting to look for Taylor after we see Taylor has disappeared. And he goes pretty much through the same beats in the typical sequel way, where you're kind of rehashing the original, where he's finding out like, oh my God, I'm on a planet, there's apes here. This isn't like Earth. Oh no, and then, you know, he finds out it's Earth, and you're like, yeah, we knew this. But the way they do it is actually kind of interesting, because they use it to introduce plot points, specifically about how the gorillas want to go into the Forbidden Zone. They want to start to cultivate the Forbidden Zone and go in there, and apparently they're having a food shortage, which I don't remember being brought up in the last film, but maybe it was. And they know that there is something there, there might be humans there or something, and they want to go into the Forbidden Zone and attack these humans, take it over and cultivate it for the apes. That's when James Franciscus' character of Brent goes with Nova, the girl from the first film, and witnesses all this, and then he is taken in by the same ape allies that Taylor had, Zara and Cornelius, where he somehow kind of coincidentally finds them. After a while, he's kidnapped by the apes and he gets out and he frees himself, and then he finds this underground version of New York City, because I guess where the apes are located is in New York City because of the famous, spoilers I guess, Statue of Liberty scene. He goes underground and he finds the Queensborough Plaza subway station, follows it, realizes, you know, this is Earth and all that stuff. And then he goes under the subway and discovers a city of mind-reading mutants who now live in the ruins of New York City. And when he finds these mutants, he discovers that they are worshiping a nuclear bomb as their religion. He's kind of stuck there as their prisoner as the apes come to try to attack and take back the Forbidden Zone. It is kind of hard to recommend this movie at all without telling you the entire plot. I didn't blow everything, but I think that's really what makes it interesting. Instead of kind of just making a rehashing, or they had many different ideas, one of which was Charlton Heston starting a human uprising 14 years in the future, where he's been stuck there and he helps a human uprising against the apes, and Rod Serling was brought in at one point because he helped write the original, and nobody really came up with one until Paul Dean, who also wrote Goldfinger and The Spy Who Came In From the Cold. And he isn't really someone you'd expect to write a film like this, because this film is very strange. It is very 70s. Part of the reason I like it, and I think a lot of people like it, is because it's such an interesting time capsule of the period when the gorillas are going to war. You have ape protesters with signs and everything trying to stop the gorillas from going to war. And then when it's being broken up, I'm sure people were thinking of Kent State. I think at the time it might have not have seemed as odd as it does now. There are certain parts that are obviously trying to echo the times that this was made in, but I love the idea of the mutants worshiping an atomic bomb, because it's such a strange idea, but it makes you actually interested in seeing a Planet of the Apes sequel. I think if it was just a continuation of him being stuck there or something, it wouldn't be as interesting. But because it takes such a strange left turn, and that there's these humans who were mutated by radiation because there was some nuclear bomb incident, which we still haven't really figured out what happened, but there was some nuclear bomb that destroyed everything and the apes took over after that, and these humans were mutated horribly and have mind-reading powers. And at certain points, you just hear these little noises like bing, bing. It's supposed to mean that they're talking in his mind and we can't hear it as an audience. Eventually, they speak in that very Hollywood way. We don't speak, it's so primitive. It's done in such a strange, like, 70s science fiction way, and its statement about religion and following religion blindly is a lot more cutting. I think the thing that's shocking is how much more cutting and all the political undercurrents that you could have in a major motion picture sequel at this time. This was directed by Ted Post, who would do a film like The Baby, which is a cult classic. He combines a lot of shocking imagery, particularly these mutants can do a lot of illusions and play with people's minds and make people attack each other so they don't need to worry about their enemies. And one of the images they show to the apes, which involves their religion with the lawgiver like crying blood and these apes crucified upside down, is pretty shocking. And it's surprising because they actually cut out a half ape, half man child because of the insinuation of bestiality, because they felt that they would lose their G rating. But I guess apes crucified upside down and bleeding with fire all around them was totally okay to get a G rating, and they like didn't think anything of that. But you know, bestiality, that's too far. But this ridiculous imagery we have created, that's fine, I guess. It's pretty shocking, and I think this is kind of one of those films you just want to experience because it seems like such a radical idea and has kind of a dark nihilism to it. This is a far darker film than the original, and it has a very bleak worldview, which I think was pretty common at the time because of Vietnam and the political situation, or the simple idea that people could be blindly following and worshiping a nuclear bomb. It's very early 1970s. It shows a stranger, odder kind of way to take a franchise than I think a lot of people would now. They just want another big action film. I think that's kind of what makes Beneath the Planet of the Apes special, is that it made a different kind of Planet of the Apes movie that's incredibly different from the first one. Just as you think it's kind of like your average sequel, it takes this weird left turn. Part of me is never as into the beginning part. It's actually decently directed. I don't think it's like too paint by numbers, but it's enough that you're kind of like, okay, I mean, this guy just, you know, James Franciscus looks like Charlton Heston. He's doing the same beats. He feels like somebody who you bring in to replace Charlton Heston. But then when they take in this bizarre area that almost feels like you're watching an episode of The Prisoner, this is the film that made me reassess the Planet of the Apes films. When I was a kid, I had seen the original and I was mostly told it was a cheesy science fiction film and it was a big deal when it came out, but not anymore. And then when I rewatched these recently, especially with Blu-ray transfers that they have now, these films are really beautiful if you can get the Blu-ray transfers. But I didn't really take any of the sequels seriously at all. And then I had been told about this film when Rise of the Planet of the Apes came out. I was kind of curious about the franchise. And this is a good one to turn you on to more of them, because it shows you, you know, the political allegories that Planet of the Apes tries to put into its films. You know, this one is more heavy-handed. As silly as the idea of a Planet of the Apes is, I think this is really the sci-fi franchise that was the big deal before Star Wars. This is the second one at 7 years before the first Star Wars came out. It's such a strange, odd, kind of weird, arty follow-up to Planet of the Apes in a way that keeps this franchise kind of fresh and not just a simple rehashing, even though it kind of plays like it is at the beginning. Beneath the Planet of the Apes takes it in such a weird, strange direction, but one that has more of the nihilism that was going on in the era. It kind of shows how things had changed since the last film came out in 68 and this came out in 70. Beneath the Planet of the Apes is part cult fascination for me and part a film I actually enjoy. I think the original is like an actually a good movie. It's a science fiction classic. It's very well made. This one, it didn't have the greatest budget. It didn't have Charlton Heston, but it kind of makes good with it, more so than, you know, you think of something like The Bourne Legacy. Usually those kind of sequels are rather lamer, but this film took a lot of liberties, maybe not with the ape kid, but with everything else. It showed like what used to be able to do with a studio project. It's kind of one of those things like that came out from a studio and was actually G at the time? How did that happen? It kind of shows you how different our culture was then. And that's part of the reason I really like it. It's such a cool concept, you know, somebody worshiping an atomic bomb underneath a Planet of the Apes. It's kind of trippy, it's kind of weird, but I think it shows kind of the potential that this franchise really has. And if you're someone who's kind of on the fence about them, and they're like, oh, Planet of the Apes are stupid, try to rent or see a good new transfer of Beneath the Planet of the Apes or the Planet of the Apes, and you really turn around and understand why these films are a big deal and why these captured people's imaginations. And I can't imagine seeing the first film and seeing it taken in this direction, where I don't think this could never really surpass the first film, but it puts up a good enough argument that makes you kind of still surprised at what they can do after a film that definitely had one of the great surprise endings of all time. I think this film is kind of just as surprising, but in a whole different way, in a way that's probably going to keep you up at night thinking about nuclear devastation. And what more could you ask for from a mainstream Hollywood sequel? So if you have seen Beneath the Planet of the Apes and you would like to talk about it, then comment below in the comments and subscribe if you would like to. And tomorrow I will have my review of Dawn of the Planet of the Apes. And I don't think it'll be too long after I post this one. And also, I forgot to mention that this is the only Planet of the Apes film to not have Roddy McDowall, which is kind of sad, except for at the beginning, but he doesn't play Cornelius in this film.